project the fact that I'm going to raise a couple of problems. And therefore, I want you to project that I'm going to raise several problems.
Well, just forget that you're going to forget.
Right. Therefore, I thought we'd just go on innocently as we proceed in our plodding way.
That's normal.
And take a look at one small position. Therefore, let's jump to section 200D. Here's the position. This evening will be very slight, modest. Because many of us have had a tiring day, took various trips here and there, Ryan, and relax. I myself went north.
From Warner?
Yeah. Really exciting. So,
David?
Good evening.
Pardon?
Good evening.
Good evening.
Which one do you want to play?
I'll be Socrates.
All right. We need a Theaetetus?
I'll be Theaetetus.
Great. All right, so 200D, page 140, Cornford, and Roosley. Low if you want.
I've got that Cornford. Do you mind if I read that, or should I try and find that one?
Yeah, it's fine.
Which one did you want to use?
Oh, I've got the Cornford. That's
the Cornford, and then we'll jump to the other.
What is one to say that knowledge is? For surely we are not going to give up yet.
Not unless you do so.
Then tell me, what definitions can we give with the least risk of contradicting ourselves?
The one we tried before, Socrates. I have nothing else to suggest.
What was that?
That true belief is knowledge. Surely there can at least be no mistake in believing what is true, and the consequences are always satisfactory.
Try and you will see, Theaetetus, as the man said when he was asked if the river was too deep to ford, so here if we go forward on our search, we may stumble upon something that will reveal the thing we are looking for. We shall make nothing out of it, nothing out. If we stay where we are.
True. Let us go forward and see.
Well, we need not go far to see this much. You will find a whole profession to prove that true belief is not knowledge.
How so? What profession?
The profession of those paragons of intellect known as orators and lawyers. There you have men who use their skill to produce conviction, not by instruction, but by making people believe whatever they want them to believe. You can hardly imagine teachers so clever as to be able, in the short time allowed by the clock, to instruct their hearers thoroughly in the true facts of a case of robbery or other violence which those hearers had not witnessed.
No, I cannot imagine that, but they can convince them.
And by convincing you, mean making them believe something?
Of course.
And when a jury is rightly convinced of facts which can be known only by an eyewitness, then, judging by hearsay and accepting a true belief, they are judging without knowledge, although if they find the right verdict, their conviction is correct.
Certainly.
But if true belief and knowledge were the same thing, the best of jurymen could never have a correct belief without knowledge. It now appears that they must be different things.
Oh, yes, Socrates. I have heard someone make...
Okay, so this is no.
Okay.
On that basis, he rejects the claim that true belief is knowledge. Right? Sorry.
Now, wait a minute.
That's a criticism. Is that right?
The position is now dead.
What do you think about it?
Interesting.
What?
It's an interesting argument.
Well, what does it depend on? Why is it? What kind of criticism does Socrates make when he rejects the position? Taking this as an example.
That they're judging without knowledge? I don't have that.
Let's use the same thing now, looking at the load. All right? Would you play soft, Barbara?
Okay.
Goblin.
Then, my boy, is the argument right in rebuking us and pointing out that we are wrong to abandon knowledge and seek first for false opinion? It is impossible to know the latter until we have adequately comprehended the nature of knowledge.
As the case now stands, Socrates, we cannot help thinking as you say.
To begin then at the beginning once more, what shall we say knowledge is? For surely we are not going to give it up yet, are we?
Not by any means, unless, that is, you give it up.
Tell us then what definition will make us contradict ourselves least.
The one we tried before, Socrates. At any rate, I have nothing else to offer.
What one?
That knowledge is true opinion. For true opinion is surely free from error, and all its results are fine and good.
The man who was leading the way through the river, Theaetetus, said, the result itself will show. And so in this matter, if we go on with our search, perhaps the thing will turn up in our path and of itself reveal the object of our search. But if we stay still, we shall discover nothing.
You are right. Let us go on with our investigation.
Well then, this at least calls for slight investigation. For you have a whole profession which declares that true opinion is not knowledge.
How so? What profession is it?
The profession of those who are greatest in wisdom, who are called orators and lawyers. For they persuade men by the art which they possess, not teaching them, but making them have whatever opinion they like. Or do you think there are any teachers so clever as to be able, in the short time allowed by the water clock, satisfactorily to teach the judges the truth about what happened to people who have been robbed of their money or have suffered other acts of violence when there were no eyewitnesses?
I certainly do not think so, but I think they can persuade them.
And persuading them is making them have an opinion, is it not?
Of course.
Then when judges are justly persuaded about matters which one can know only by having seen them and in no other way, in such a case, judging of them from hearsay, having acquired a true opinion of them, they have judged without knowledge, though they are rightly persuaded that the judgment they have passed is correct, have they not?
Certainly.
But my friend, if true opinion and knowledge were the same thing in law courts, the best of judges could never have true opinion without knowledge. In fact, however, it appears that the two are different.
How did you do it? And what do you think of the what do you think of the way in which you pursued this? How did you do it? What's the strategy?
Well, one thing he said here is this knowledge can be learned. Because these people aren't teaching, they're persuading these orators. And then true opinion in this method is not learned, but it's accepted through being convinced, or it must be believed. He brings in the idea of the eyewitness, first-hand experience.
Let's go to a standard. All right, take a look at a standard.
Teachers.
Right. At 201.
B.
A.
A.
Let us go forward and see. Well, we need not go far to see this much. You will find a whole profession to prove that true belief is not knowledge. So, he goes to the professions. He picks one out, and he says, hey, this profession is the one we'll use to test the validity of that claim. Okay. Well, we need not go far to see this much. You will find a whole profession to prove that true belief is not knowledge. What profession? Okay. Orators? Huh? And lawyers. What? All right, look here. Let's take this out and take a look at what they do. And all we have to do is examine what they do, and you'll see we'll have to reject this. Huh? Rather curious way to go, isn't it? Right? Do you agree?
Yeah, it is kind of curious.
Hmm.
I find it. And that he's talking about eyewitnesses. As a as a sorcerer. Well, that's what I was saying.
Well, if someone were to ask me what you said, I would be real stuck because I'd say, so far as I remember, you chopped it in half and kept half.
Yeah.
Okay. We're back to how quickly.
Well, I was struck by the fact that he was using eyewitnesses as a rationale for saying that knowledge is not true belief.
Huh?
Well, in that since the juries are basing their judgment on hearsay rather than on eyewitness reports, they have to believe the eyewitnesses.
Well, what are they basing it on? I thought they
hearsay.
Said they didn't have. Yeah.
Judging of
Jan, it looks like
hearsay.
You got a piece. Looks like you got a piece. And you're pushing it. Is that right?
Yeah, and the original argument was knowledge is not perception. And
right?
Here,
now you're going.
Can you set up an analogy?
Well,
no,
No,
you're picking an idea and you're talking about it, right? And you're saying, hey, I find this interesting because of other things.
Yeah, what the original argument was, okay.
Yeah. But how about pursuing that for a moment?
Oh, I don't mind pursuing it.
What's the next element? No. What is the next element in how Socrates rejects the position? Mm-hmm. That's what we're after. And I'm not saying that what you're saying is not interesting on some level, but how about just getting this, knocking this off first?
Oh, sure.
Okay, what's the next element? Mm-hmm. What does it presuppose, again, in the next paragraph?
These guys have an art?
Yeah, they have a skill.
A skill, right. It's not art.
Right. Second, right?
They have a skill.
Right. To produce conviction.
Yeah, they're able to persuade.
Right. To produce opinion, doxa.
Uh-huh.
To convince, right? To conviction. So,
is that the word that they have in Greek? Skill.
Should be. Can't be tuxedo. Bar, where are you?
Well, it's at right on. It's on 201. It's like three lines in, and it's techne. They persuade by the art. By the art of them, they persuade, not teaching, but making to opine what they wish, making those people to opine what they wish.
Mm-hmm. It is technique.
Greatest, well,
mm-hmm.
You know, he also says, the greatest,
In wisdom.
So, I mean, there's got to be some level of sarcasm.
Sounds like it, doesn't it?
Or.
The greatest in wisdom.
Much like, not sarcasm, but what we were talking about is rhetoric.
Yeah. I think this is truer than Cornford, where they persuade men of the art which they possess, not teaching them, but making them have whatever opinion they like. And so it keeps going back to this, and that's right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Because it's true opinion, then the language stays the same. All right, what does that tell us then? Right? He's picking a among the professions, those who are most skilled at it. Right? And then he underlines their skill to produce opinions. And he makes it whatever opinion they like. That's how good they are. They can produce opinions. Any they like. Agree? Or do you think that there are any teachers so clever as to be able, in the short time allowed by the water clock, satisfactorily to teach the judges the truth about what happened to people who have been robbed of their money or have suffered of acts of violence when they were no eyewitnesses? Right.
Yeah.
Right, they can believe it's true when there are no eyewitnesses. And persuading them is to make them have an opinion, is it not? Of course. Then when judges are justly persuaded about matters, which one can know only by having seen them, and in no other way, in such a case, judging of them from hearsay, having acquired a true opinion of them, they are judged without knowledge, though they have rightly persuaded if the judgment they have passed is correct, have they not? So now he's focusing on the rightly or the true. Yes. But my friend, the true opinion and knowledge were the same thing. In law courts, the best of judges could never have true opinion without knowledge. Hmm. In fact, however, it appears that you are different.
Well, there would be one and the same. Never have true opinion without knowledge, because it wouldn't be true if it didn't have knowledge. It would just be an opinion.
Okay, so how do we reject that?
Or.
No.
Okay.
Those healers can.
Could you agree with this line, there were no eyewitnesses?
Right.
That's equivalent to saying no knowledge.
Right. No evidence. Yeah, no.
He says if he didn't see it, how could they know it?
That's right. No knowledge, even perception.
Sure. Yeah. And this is the point that Jay was making earlier. Right? That looks like he's using to reject this position something that he formally rejected.
Mm-hmm.
That is, that knowledge is perception.
Right.
Sure. Except there's a line there that we need, which one can know only by having seen it in no other way.
Ah, that puts knowledge in that context, then. He's described what he means by knowledge.
Right. There's a class, then, of knowledge which one can know only by having seen them along the way. Okay, look here, then. No eyewitnesses, no knowledge. Well, then, even when they reach a right or a true opinion, they are still without knowledge, aren't they?
Mm-hmm.
Right? This is a curious argument, isn't it?
Look at that.
Now, let me point out one of the things I find curious about. Even when they are right, when they pass judgment, even when they're right, that is to say, when they have the true opinion, there's a part of the argument which is missing.
Mm-hmm.
go back and look at the way it opened up. First paragraph of the argument. Margaret, where are we below?
From the profession?
Then my boy.
Right from the beginning.
Then, my boy, is the argument right in rebuking us and pointing out that we were wrong to abandon knowledge and seek first for false opinion? It is impossible to know the latter until we have adequately comprehended the nature of knowledge.
Now, let's go to 200E, page 219. The one we have tried before, Socrates. At any rate, I have nothing else to offer. What one? Go ahead, Barbara.
That knowledge is true opinion. For true opinion is surely free from error, and all its results are fine and good.
Look at Cornford.
That true belief is knowledge. Mm-hmm. Surely there can at least be no mistake in believing what is true, and the consequences are always satisfactory.
See, the position really is that knowledge is true opinion with a stipulation where the consequences are satisfactory.
Mm-hmm.
Right, has two parts, doesn't it?
Yeah, it wouldn't be true opinion if the consequences weren't satisfactory.
Or it wouldn't
so,
be knowledge.
Yeah. So he deals with that part at 201C, doesn't he?
Uh-huh. Yeah, down with the judges. You know, they judged and they made the right choice.
If the judgment they have passed is correct, I mean, mm-hmm. then it's kind of then the consequences are okay. Mm-hmm. But could you not take this as, like in the modern sense, knowledge can be said to be opinion, so long as the consequences are predictable or satisfactory? It's in that sense that he doesn't deal with that part of it, but he treats it as if the judgment they have passed is correct. But leave that as
you mean a like point. Mathematics?
Yeah. So, what do you think this is a proof?
It's interesting that he would go to lawyers and orators that it doesn't seem like he thinks too highly about, instead of the mystics and the analogy, instead of someone who would have more respect for.
Yeah, he picks the profession, the orators and the lawyers, and he says, hey, take a look at them. They have skill to produce opinion. Matter of fact, any that they like. Right? And somehow they can produce truth when no eyewitnesses were present. Right? They can come to the heart of the matter in some cases. Right? Cannot lawyers try to recreate the scene? And so, there's no eyewitnesses, there's no one there who really saw what was going on, yet they can reconstruct a case, and they can come out, in some cases, would you not agree, with a true opinion about the matter?
Mm-hmm. But he's saying that that's impossible, that you can't have true opinion without knowledge.
Well,
next paragraph. If true opinion and knowledge were the same thing in the law course, the best of judges could never have true opinion without. Well, that's right. They're not the same.
Not the same.
Yeah, but they're not the same.
Yeah. So look here. So here he's saying then, therefore there's a difference. And the difference is on this side. Eyewitnesses.
Yeah.
People who can see it, right, have a basis for their claim. Right? Basis for their claim for knowledge.
Their experience.
Work. Okay. Say, let me now get to the next point in my effort. I'm assuming, of course, that everyone has read the dialogue. Would you not agree we can get a whole list of the positions that are rejected? This is one of them.
Yeah.
And I'll put another one just
perception.
So I'm familiar with the dialogue and all of those perceptions. Right. The most difficult one. And again, this is knowledge is true opinion. Good. Say, let's assume now we can talk about all of these different positions that have been rejected. Right, they're especially the last three. Especially the last three. So let's go back to an analogy.
Peter, can I?
Mm-hmm.
They have, you know, like on number two, the position rejected, knowledge is true opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the true is a qualifier for opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And I would think that if you're holding an argument and taking a position, that you wouldn't need qualifiers.
This would be that this kind of knowledge presupposes that someone else knows it's true. You don't. Someone else does.
Secondhand.
Yeah. Like there is someone who does know and can judge the opinion you reached is true. And the consequences are satisfactory. But he doesn't know it. The man who's making the judgment doesn't know it. And therefore, what do you want to say about him?
Can't have knowledge of
it. Well, he can't have true opinion?
No, because he doesn't have knowledge of it.
Of the truth. Yes, he doesn't know it's a true opinion. But he has a true opinion. He doesn't know it's true.
Oh, okay.
He doesn't know. He just has an opinion.
Okay.
He hopes it's true. He convinces everybody. But this presupposes that someone else who knows that it is true. Therefore, in the judgments that he does make, some are true.
Yeah.
Now the possibility is, at that time, is that knowledge? Because he doesn't know it's true.
Okay.
It's like Santa Anita.
Yeah.
If you win, you knew, right?
I know some of you are not going to be able to do as well as I do. This is a kind of a before and after diagram.
Underwater explosions?
No.
Oh, water. I felt sure I recognized the contour of the sea.
These are seeds.
Oh.
I thought there were guppies.
No, these are seeds in the soil. Please go for you people to 150.
Thank you.
Oh, we're talking about the farmer's art, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, watch. He calls this, in this example, knowledge.
What's your deposit there?
150. $149 E.
What's it growing?
Oh, you probably don't have too much skill.
Well, they're young plants. They haven't fully developed yet.
That's corn. That's growing corn. It's for people who...
It's not family.
It's apropos.
Blow. Corn. Now, I'm going to pull a dirty trick on you, by the way, so. What? Oh, shit, did you say?
Oh, good, she said. Oh. I overheard it.
Barbara, Franuison is not knowledge.
Right.
Is that a question?
That's what they call a tag question. Is it?
Right.
No, it isn't. It's from same root as phronesis.
Mm-hmm. This line in the Greek, so.
So it should be, do you think, the understanding?
Be assured that they are prouder of this than of their skill in cutting the umbilical cord. Just consider, do you think the of what soil is best for each plant to seed belongs to the same art? Well, as Barbara goes through that, let me give you the problem. All right? I'm going to call this, for the moment, knowledge.
Gignosce.
Gignos.
Gignosce. The infinitive.
I see. See, after this time, that's the stem I was the one that keep using.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, look.
What's the distinction you just made?
Don't worry about it. We'll go right back to it. Because I want you to just forget about it and use this word for a moment. All right?
Knowledge.
Yeah. Say, would you agree there's a whole group of positions that are being rejected in the dialogue of Theaetetus? Each time one of them is rejected, please go back to this model. It's a model. And see whether it includes this particular knowledge or not.
What particular knowledge?
Well, he says there is a knowledge of knowing the right seed for the right soil.
Mm-hmm.
And the knowledge that goes along with tending and harvesting and all belong to one art. That's a knowledge, he calls it.
Okay.
All right. Now, any part of this that is called knowledge, I want to know whether you would say that either in part or whole is being rejected among those positions that we are looking at in the Theaetetus. Am I clear?
Mm-hmm. I don't understand.
He has an idea of knowledge here, doesn't he?
Mm.
Let me give an example from this case. All right? Here you see an observer. Good picture of an observer?
Very good.
Good. Now, matter of fact, let me even do it even better. This man has been working very arduously, as you can see. And now, after work, he describes everything he does to this man. So this man knows, in that sense, everything that he's done. He tells him everything that happened. Now, he can now, if he has the skill of persuasion, can he not convince other people about how to farm?
Yeah.
They got it, somebody heard it and
must have
it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can he not? Mm-hmm. So then Socrates is saying, hey, we're not going to call that knowledge. What he's doing, we're not going to call knowledge. Even though he could be far more persuasive than the farmer. Mm-hmm. And make many points about it. Matter of fact, probably teach it. And be do a better job than he could teach it. In some respect.
Yeah.
So long as he's using the content.
Mm-hmm. Probably better speaker. Puts words
probably
together.
Better speaker.
Alright. Tells jokes.
Mm-hmm. Now, going back to this argument, right? Is he therefore saying there's only one man in this? Alright. Now he lectures. Right? There's a podium. He's got many students, and they praise his skill and his knowledge. Might they not? Socrates is saying, hey, look, I'll tell you, in this picture, there's only one dude who's got it. That's him. Is that right? There's only one dude who's got it. Whatever this is, that could be, in fact, true opinion. But this is the man. Who knows? Right? Mm-hmm. So look here. That's why I'm interested in any part of this. Let me make an example. One of the theories of knowledge that Plato uses, which we should get to, it's a simple one. Let me give now an example of what I mean that relates to this example. On page 155. There's an article, there's an argument here, that true knowledge, let us call it, is the enumeration of all the elements. Okay, look here. Let's go back to this. Now, is it not possible that this farmer, because of his knowledge, can enumerate all the different kinds of seeds? Can he not necessarily enumerate the different kinds of soils which should be brought together to produce the best kind of crop? Should he not? Not possible? Look here. But this by itself is inadequate, because he points out the inadequacy of that. But just because you can enumerate all the elements doesn't mean you know. Right? Agree? Maybe we can go through that argument. Now look here. In other words, could this man's knowledge in this loose sense of talking that we have over here, and these positions are rejected, could we not say this man should also have knowledge of all the soils, knowledge of all the seeds? And so as we go through this list, we can list a whole bunch of things that he might be said to know. But taken by themselves is inadequate. Pardon?
Possibility.
Right.
What do you mean exactly, again, taken by themselves?
Well, you mean, suppose someone were to say...
You mean if a doctor knew the same thing? That's taking it by itself?
No. Let us say, let's take the doctor example. Someone might say, in order to be a physician, to be a good physician, there are many kinds of knowledge you must have. And let me give you the first. To know all the parts of the body, to know all the names for them, and that is called anatomy.
Mm-hmm. Memorizing yourself.
Right. Yeah. Socrates might say, excuse me, I understand that position. We call that being able to enumerate all of the parts, or all of the elements.
Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean you know anatomy. Yeah.
Wait a minute. It doesn't mean it's knowledge. You may know all the names, but he's saying there's something intrinsically false in allowing that to go by the name of knowledge. By itself, that's not knowledge. Now, let's take another one, all right? Say you can enumerate all of the elements and you're able to make a particular distinction, right? You're able to say, this is totally different from anything else, and that's making a distinction, or being able to recognize some particular distinguishing mark of something. Right? That is to say, if I know the particular differences in things, that could be a claim to knowledge, could it not?
I think some people would say that.
No. So, could that be found in this man's knowledge?
Sure.
In what way?
Well, he's making distinctions.
That's true. Distinguishing mark distinctions.
Distinguishing mark?
No.
He would be able to tell good quality. I don't know what you mean by distinguishing marks.
That particular difference which distinguishes one thing from all other things in the same class. Should he not be able to say, if he knows all the seeds, that there ought to be one in here that is so distinguished that it may be good or bad, mm-hmm. or the best of them and the lot? Mm-hmm. Could he not also say, because of his knowledge, that he can tell which part of his farm has the best soil, since it may vary from place to place? Mm-hmm. Could he not? Mm-hmm. That's distinguishing, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Look here. Could he not say that after the whole season is over, could he not make a judgment about one season and the other season by making distinctions between them? And could we not call that knowledge? Okay, Plato's saying, hey, I got news for you. All right? No. By itself, no. Right? Now, maybe you can push together a lot of these things that are inadequate and come up with it, or maybe there's something that isn't even there that he doesn't even cover. That is knowledge. Let me go further. Why don't I go further? These are inadequate. There's something missing. Agree? And that's why they're rejected. Yeah. They should have certain features, and they don't have them. They're inadequate. They're inadequate. There's something missing in each of those positions, which is why they're rejected.
Taken individually, there's something inadequate, or pulling them all together? In each one, there's something inadequate. You say that each one can be considered knowledge.
Each one, they make a claim for knowledge. Each one is shown to be inadequate.
Okay. How about all together?
Well, you'll figure that out when you do.
Oh, okay. I see.
Right. You wouldn't want me.
I thought you were saying that
no,
all
I said there's even some that aren't here. So if you put them all together, there's still something that's inadequate.
Oh, okay.
Okay, look. Let's say they are these. A, B, C, D. Alright, just symbolically for a moment. Okay, look here. Can these theories be said to be incommensurable with one another and with knowledge? Okay. Let me go back now to D to 148 D or so somewhere. That example that he uses, that mathematical example, is it just innocent? Or does it fit? Is he saying that they're incommensurable? There are certain kinds of numbers which are incommensurable? Certain kinds of lines are incommensurable? With others? To others? Are certain kinds of knowledge in a similar way? Can we call them incommensurable? If we look at all of these that have been rejected, does that mean that as we look at each one of these, that there is no common measure, no basic same unit that's in each?
That's what that would mean, incommensurable.
Yeah. In other words, there's the whole dialogue in this mathematical and in this model of the Farman. Put it another way, all right? Let's say for the moment that there may be things that are adequate. If there are knowledges, if there are knowledges, let A, B, and C, and D be them. Should they not have some common measure throughout all of them? Let me suggest the farmer and midwifery and philosophical midwifery. Did they share a common feature which gives us an insight into the nature of this question about knowledge? And do they, having something that they share in common through them all, make them in that sense commensurable? There's something common that runs through them all, which these others do not have, and therefore they can be grouped together as incommensurable, lacking that thing that brings them all together into a unity. Therefore, when you read this dialogue, I would like you to keep that in mind. When each position is being rejected, and especially when we get in the digression. So, going back then to Carol's point, Barbara, let's retranslate them. How would you do it? At 149E. Now, I'm particularly interested in two words, prouder and knowledge.
Well, it looks like he's saying, but know that they, phronesis, they think it better. They think it better than think this particular thing better than the knowledge of than. Sorry, need to go again. But let me tell you my problem. In the second line, right at E, there's an article that... Okay, then. Forget it. That isn't the problem I thought it was. Okay.
But that's ennoia, jar, right?
That's think it, yeah. But you see, isthi... He wants him to know that first part, and then ennoia, have it in your news.
Mm-hmm. Have it in your news.
In this. And then he asked the question, do you think, with oye, do you think that... Sorry, Steve, what's your question?
Who was that first one having introduced? Where was that?
Just consider. That's to have it in your news. You know, consider this, it's stronger than consider, is the point. Mm-hmm. Right. Hey, have this in the better part of your mind.
There's a lot of farming words in here that I'm just not familiar with, which are...
That's okay. Well, would you say that's knowledge?
Well...
Like we're using in this text, right, episteme, all through it.
Uh-huh. Right. Episteme is definitely a different kind of knowledge than gnosko.
Right. Gnosis.
Gnosis, uh-huh.
He uses that knowledge too about talking about midwives just above at the top of the page.
Mm-hmm.
See, well, let's now just to throw the last piece into the puzzle. Last piece of the puzzle. The digression. In the digression, at one I guess it starts at 172C. There's a whole discussion of rhetoric and philosophy and the kinds of questions and the kinds of concerns that the philosopher has. What follows if the word knowledge is not among them? What follows if among the questions the philosopher asks, we can't find the question, what is knowledge?
It must not be very important to a philosopher.
Right. Now, all right. Is there knowledge in this? Okay. This is the model. Is he calling these three by the same? Then, of course, knowledge is very important because it's the commonness that runs through all three of them, and therefore you can ask what is the common feature that runs through these three things. You know what we're asking? What is knowledge? Pardon? Therefore, to have fun for a short while with this dialogue, that word plays one hell of a role in the whole dialogue. And therefore, if it's knowledge, it goes one way, and if it isn't, it goes entirely in another. And therefore, there's a higher level of sophistication in the dialogue. If everywhere he uses one word with all of the theories that he rejects about knowledge and calls those by one Greek word, and then when he talks about this kind of stuff, he uses an entirely different word, then we want to know whether the word, what the idea of what is knowledge includes in both, whether they're distinctive and different, one from the other, and therefore they should be separate. Right? Good. So, see what's at stake? So I thought I'd dump this at you, right, this evening, so that we can have a little more fun in the future. So next week what I'd like to do is, what time is it?
9:15.
What would be fun to do now would be to take this section on mathematics. Now, as you all know, these people spent a great deal of time in geometry. Their language is precise as hell. Ours isn't. Theirs is. I mean, theirs is. And I'll tell you, in this section on the mathematical model, I think there's a whole phrase in there that's just miserably translated. You know, even though I haven't even looked at the Greek, I don't feel perhaps I should make those statements before we can get these people together to look at it. But in any case, wouldn't it be interesting to see whether or not the mathematical examples that he's using have direct echoes such as I've indicated throughout the whole dialogue? So therefore, what we want to see is, what do they mean by incommensurable and commensurable? What is it? See, to be commensurable means that essentially that there's a
unit of measure.
A unit of measure which is common in all of them, which makes them what they are. There has to be a unit of measure which is common between them. Now, let me now put it in another way. Look here. when they talk about commensurables, right, or commensurable magnitudes, I won't use magnitudes, I'll use a circle. Purposely two different sizes.
But a circle, no. No.
By both circles. Right? Now, circle A, circle B. They have a number of units in them. Right? Each unit, each one, is a particular, each unit is very particular and precise. The sum number of them is n. Therefore, indeed, there's a circle with, right, with many parts, call it m. And each one of its units we'll call d. Let's say d, is that right? A, B, C, D, right. Well, if these two units are in fact units, measurable units, then the whole is commensurable, one to the other.
But they don't have to be the same.
No, they don't have to be the same. But let me put it in terms of lines now. Right. Say they use lines. Say this is line A, and this is line B. Now they say commensurate magnitudes have to one another, a ratio. Which one number has to another. So look here, if you let A be a magnitude and B a magnitude that are commensurable, then you know what you can say? Well, if that's true, then there should be some ratio which by necessity relates the number of one to the number of the other. All right, if they're commensurable, there should be some magnitude that can measure each.
What do you mean when you use the word magnitude?
That line, any line.
Okay.
Or in general, any magnitude. But using this as an example. All right, I'm saying let the unit of measure that we're talking about, call that C.
That's the magnitude also?
That's the unit. That's what we're going to call that a unit.
Oh, so only the total of the units is the magnitude.
As the great Chinese sage said, yep.
So what?
Right, okay. So, then C measures A, right? Mm-hmm. C measures A. Right? A number of times. Let that number of times be at D. 7. C also measures magnitude B. And let that be at E. Therefore, what he is saying is, when two magnitudes are commensurate, there is a ratio that they have, which is one number to another number, mm-hmm. as 7 is to 10. Therefore, there has to be some common measure, unit of measure, that's the key word, right? Standard.
Someone.
That runs through them all. If not, they are incommensurable. They don't have anything that runs through them all.
They don't have a standard.
They don't have a standard. Now, there's an exquisite proof that goes along with this, which, if you're interested, I'll do next time. Very lovely little thing.
Pierre? If on the right side you said that these items are commensurable, in a way to that has something to do with knowledge, right? That they're that they form knowledge. That's what they have in common.
There must be something that's common to these, some standard or some unit, if the analogy is correct.
Can that be stated on the right side, huh?
We don't know what that is yet.
I was wondering if a statement could be made about that right side, since it does have commensurable parts.
The one over there?
Yeah.
Yeah. And what talk about it.
I was just wondering if a statement about knowledge could be applied to that sketch on the left, if...
Analogous to this.
Right.
Well, look here.
If philosophical midwifery is to midwifery,
then there should be some common feature that runs through it all. And that same feature should also be present in, let's change it for a moment. Oh no, I don't have too much complication. Let's call it if farming, taking them all, if farming can be said to have a certain common feature that is also shared with midwifery, and that is also shared with philosophical midwifery, then there's something about the three of them that they share in common. Could that be similar to the way in which they talk in geometry about a common unit of measure among commensurables? That's our philosophical question. Now, I think there is, by the way, but I think it'd be more fun to explore. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good for coffee? What time is it? Quick.
9:25.
Oh, I wanted to be an answer.
Yes.
That's okay. My watch says 9:35 is the average.
Ah.
That puts it right off.
Unit of measure. Now, I threw a lot. Is that together?
Sure.
Yeah. What to look for? Yeah. Oh, Barbara, what the hell are we going to do with our coon? What are you going to do with that?
Am I going to do that?
Gignosco?
Gignosco. I'm going to wait until next week when I'll have all the clothes on gold.
Look at
it. I was
right, there's a lot that hangs on it.
Yeah.
Where is the one used and where's the other used?
Yeah, that's the question.
Oh, that's what you're not. That's what you're going to look up.
Well, I was thinking I could wait for the word index might give us a little
bit.
Yeah,
that gignosis is used here, here, and here.
Especially
that one
it is.
The
and in the
digression.
No.
Is
true,
is wisdom,
or
right, so that's fun.
Mm. It is used in those three models? That.
As I remember. Now I'll let Barbara talk.
Oh,
about.
Okay, that's what she's doing. Good, that's what Barbara's finding.
Well, it is used in the farmer, it is used in the wife ring. I do believe it's in the philosophical. It's used in. I believe it's in all three.
All three. But in the other places in the text where they talk
episteme.
About knowledge, it's episteme.
Right.
What were you
knowledge
saying
versus
the,
knowledge.
Huh?
What were you saying was the line in the example that you would say would be mistranslated? The line in the mathematical that you would bet. I was thinking I could go for that.
Okay.
if I had.
No, it wasn't just one muscle.
Next week.
No, I can't.
That her?
That's it.
Could that be the mouse? Hi. Hi.
Oh my goodness.
Hi.
You got Paddington.
Hiya, Leah.
I was down at the crab cooker, and she had Mr. Paddington with her. And some woman is sitting there munching on something. Looks at, she says, "My God, that Paddington bear went through hell." She said, "It's already ancient." I looked and I said, "Yeah, well, it gets fed, it gets thrown."